Attention turns to the men. The air temperature is slightly warmer. Humid morning in central London, but nigh on perfect conditions for this men's event. And the swimmers just on their way out to the banks of the Serpentine. Six laps of a circuit of around about 1.7 kilometres, 10 kilometres in total in the water. It is a beautiful setting. The atmosphere should be fantastic. This was where the two triathlons were held last weekend. There was a thrilling finish in the women's race, just as there was in the 10-kilometre marathon yesterday. So many questions to be answered here. So many big-name performers in the open water swimming events. It's part of a World Series now, and Giannitis of Greece and Lertz of Germany, two of the favourites, but Nico Livingstone alongside me, there is maybe a surprise element to this one, given that there is an African athlete who has performed in the pool already, and many say that he will be the star performer here.
First time Osama Mololi will race in both the swimming pool and the open water, known as marathon swimming at Olympic competition. As we look at the course, it's about 1.67 in kilometres per lap, 1.7 kilometres for the purpose of easy calculation. So they'll do six laps of that, and as you said, Tony, we saw a great women's race that came down to a sprint finish only separated by 0.4 of a second. When they finish, they must touch or slap a timing board that is hanging above the finish area. So Osama Mololi is the big question mark. He's not been in open water racing too often. In fact, he says that really the only lure of racing in the open water is the fact that there is a medal on offer. Otherwise, he wouldn't be out there. He says the water quality, well, you can't really see too much out there, so it doesn't look that inviting, he said, in the lead up to the race. But he's in great form, finishing third at the Olympic Games here in the 1500, of course winning the 1500 back in 2008. So he has a very fast turn of speed, but he's in very good shape. And his training partner, Hayley Anderson from the US, won the silver medal in the women's event.
So there is a bit of form going into this race as we check on the starters. You talk about close finishes. They had a 10-kilometre race in Mexico earlier this year, and it was, in the end, almost a dead heat. It needed a photo finish to separate the two leaders on that occasion. The two gold medal favourites going into the games here in London, Lertz of Germany and Giannitis of Greece. Supremely fit. They're vastly experienced. There is Lertz. He will be wearing number 12.
Looks in great fitness.
Yeah, I was going to say, he was back in Athens. He was in the 1500 metres. He's another one who's converted successfully from the pool to the open water. Took bronze in the 10K in Beijing. Undefeated in his last 10 races at World Championships over 5 and 10 kilometres.
Well, you'll notice here the boys, they have things hanging out the back of their swimming costumes. They are feeds. So there's Mololi wearing the black cap with the Tunisian flag. So they will take on feed at the station, but they'll also take it on during the race.
Mololi, world and Olympic champion over 1500 metres. This is very, very different, however. And there's the usual scrum in the water after they've dived in. And already there's a swimmer who is at the back of the field.
Well, I think it was actually Thomas Lutz. He actually chose just to cruise in, and we'll get a closer look in a moment. But certainly for two of the competitors, the tactic was just to wait. Let them all go, because quite obviously yesterday in the women's race, we saw a lot of elbows, a lot of contact. There were, in fact, four or five yellow flags given out. So it is not clear water out there, but a couple of them just choosing to just sit back so they can have some clear water.
Well, we saw that in the women's race, the fact that there was so much buffeting and bumping and boarding going on in the early stages, which can affect technique, can't it? It can be an unnecessary pressure to the athlete, the swimmer in the water.
Well, there's Lert. So it wasn't him. It was another swimmer with black costume and grey cap. So we'll wait to see who it was that sat back. But unlike the pool swimming, you'll also notice that the boys are allowed to wear a suit that covers their chest. The new regulations for pool swimming is that the boys must swim with an uncovered chest. So they just wear what is equivalent to bike pants. So Mololi, leads it already. Will he lead from start to finish? The very familiar stroke of Osama Mululi there off to the left-hand side. Now coming across to the right-hand side. Beautiful technician. We'll have an opportunity to study the technique of Osama Mululi and the other swimmers in there. The other one that, you know, the word on the street is to really watch out for is Daniel Fogg as well. This is the last opportunity to win a gold medal for Britain in swimming. This is the last of the swimming program. And they've come out so far without a gold medal, which for some it's been disappointing.
And Daniel Fogg, who's wearing 19, he is a Londoner. He was born in Edmonton, close to the Olympic Park, studying sports science at Loughborough University. Another one who competes in the pool, 1500 meters freestyle. Won a Commonwealth bronze at that level too. He was in the World Championship 10K back in 2009. Steady pace early on as we look at Weinberger, the competitor from Canada. Weinberger, who's a policeman who swims for a club in Germany. Or rather, it's Weinberger, who's the German who's who's in Max Ritter, the Max Ritter Club in Germany. Another one who featured at the World Championships last year. He was successful in the FINA World Cup. He picked up a bronze medal.
Well, we're just starting to identify numbers with technique. So Daniel Fogg is wearing the blue cap, number 19. And the water temperature that we indicated at the start has been readjusted. There has been some temperature taken this morning and they're suggesting that it is closer to 21 degrees, which is very comfortable for the athletes. So Thomas Lertz, just so that you know, he's without the cap. He's got a bald head, a shaved head. And he's wearing the number 12. So he's one that we need to watch as well. But at the moment, it's the black cap of Osama Mululi in these very early stages where the boys are not rushed at all. Just getting into some nice technique. The girls' race, the pace is normally on from the very start. But the boys tend to try to play a little bit more with tactics. But no sense of urgency or rushing at the moment. It's almost like a masterclass on how to swim. Very correct freestyle. It's just a shame we don't have any underwater camera shots for you to have a look from an underwater perspective.
Wouldn't be a very clear view either. That's always one of the issues. The state of the water where open water, or in this case a marathon event, is held. The Serpentine in the center of London. There's plenty of wildlife here. There's no jellyfish, but it is rather murky, as you might expect. It was specially constructed, this lake. It's one right. Anybody who's been to London who knows the centre of the city will know that Hyde Park was the site of the Great Exhibition back in the 19th century. Hyde Park divided by the Serpentine. Actually covers an area which is bigger than the Principality of Monaco, although it is actually smaller than Central Park in New York.
Well, just coming around the first of the turning boys, and this is where it is quite violent. A clash of arms, a clash of legs, a change of direction. It's almost like rowing a boat where you are working with one arm more than the other. So around this buoy, you would be working a little bit more with your left arm and just taking some smaller strokes with your right arm just to change direction. Of course, they're so proficient with what they do. They do it with ease and we wouldn't even notice it. But from a feeling point of view, that is definitely what you feel like.
It's always better to feel relaxed. Mm. And this opening lap is really an opportunity to get some rhythm and to warm up a little bit.
Well, the other really interesting thing about swimming that people don't often think about is technically what you see on top of the water is called the recovery portion of swimming. So recovery actually means just that. It's meant to be easy. It's meant to be an opportunity to actually recover. So all of the work is being done underwater and the overarm portion, the recovery portion, should actually be quite relaxed. And you will see that with the Osama Mululi, as opposed to some of the other swimmers that don't have as proficient technique, that it does look like he's just recovering with the above the water. Look at that. It's just, It's glorious to watch Daniel Fogg sitting on his feet from Great Britain, but you can see his hand goes in, but then it extends. You can see it through the quality of the water. It does extend forward, and then the reach part under the body doesn't happen until he's finished that forward extension. Nice high elbows, just dragging the legs. All of the boys just dragging the legs at the moment. So it's just used for balance. We've got a Canadian up there as well, have we?
Yes, Weinberger. Have to be careful because we've got Weinberger of Canada who's wearing 21 and Vashberger of Germany is wearing number 10.
Okay.
Weinberger, the 22-year-old. And there is Vashberger, number 10. Weinberger was actually the runner-up in the FINA qualifier, which was held in Portugal.
And I've actually identified Thomas Lertz incorrectly. He's wearing a grey cap, and it's Weinberger that's got the shaved head, the bald head. So he is right up there, the Canadian. So he is number 21. I was almost dyslexic then, getting my numbers back to front. He's 21, Weinberger, with the shaved head, no cap. And Lertz is number 12 with the silver cap on. Now here's the start. Three boys just choosing to hang back. Interesting choice, given that the boys would go so fast. We might get a better look as to who they were. Not quite.
Quite deliberate act to stay out of trouble.
Kai Hurst off to a pretty good start there as well. Haven't seen him in that front pack yet, but they are quite close when we resume coverage of the swimming action. Great shots for the photographers off the pontoon on the Serpentine. It's the Russian that decided to stay back. Number 15.
Bolshikov, who is coached by Dmitry Belov. Took bronze in the 10K at the World Championship last year. Sixth over 5 kilometres, but there is the leader, the clear leader at the moment.
Well, Osama Maluli, apart from having a gold and a bronze in the cabinet already, as we take a look at Daniel Fogg sitting in second at the moment. Osama Maluli is 6'4" in height, and that's 192 centimetres. He's 84 kilos or 185 pounds. He's not the tallest in the field though. We do have one of the boys at 6'5", and that's Reichman from Belgium. So just getting a glimpse of the field now. There's Kai Hurst, number 4, to the left of screen. Number 14 is there as well, Stoichev. So nice positioning. And there is the American as well. So Alex Meyer is in there. Interesting story with him having to come back from a broken collarbone. Sustained that injury training for this Olympic Games preparation out on his bike. So he's had an interesting preparation, but is certainly determined to make this event count.
Meyer, the world 25K champion back in 2010. He finished fourth over 5 kilometres in Shanghai. He's another one who has the ability to swim right across the ranges. There's 5, 10 and 25-kilometre races in both world championship events and indeed the World Cup events, which have now been added to the program, but only the 10K currently in the Olympic Games. Only the second time that the 10K marathon has been swum at the Olympic Games, making its debut in China 4 years ago. It was won then by Martin van der Weyden of the Netherlands, who actually retired afterwards, felt that he had then done enough. And given the training and the amount of time that the swimmers both spend in the open water and the pool, it's perhaps understandable that he needed a fresh challenge and felt that he'd done enough.
Well, given also his remarkable story that he had come back from having cancer as well and had then not only recovered and stayed in remission and was clear of cancer and then coming back to win the Olympic Games gold medal, it was a remarkable story. On that topic, it's not a very nice topic, I'm sure. The boys in lead up to this Olympic Games are missing one of their compatriots, and that's Fran Crippen, who unfortunately passed away during a race. Very hot conditions on that day and still subject of much discussion through the swimming fraternity as to safety measures in place. And the boys now, it's almost a legacy thanks to Fran Crippen that there are so many more safety implements out there, and even to the point that the boys talk about going around buoys or going around turning cans and seeing scuba divers there just to make sure that they're okay. So I'm sure that they will be thinking of Fran today. and many of them paying tribute to him and his legacy.
Yeah, the swimmer from the United States who back in 2010 was one of the leading competitors in marathon or open water swimming, died during a race in the United Arab Emirates. It was only at the finish that anybody noticed that he was missing. It was Alex Meyer who realized that he wasn't with the finishers, and Thomas Lertz claimed later that the water temperature was around 30 degrees, and the question has been asked, was the water temperature and those extreme temperatures in the Middle East responsible or in part responsible?
Sometimes you'll never know, but I know the boys do miss Fran, and they'll be swimming for him today as well. As we take a look at the lead swimmer in the formation of almost a V, but they're heading in, some swimmers deciding, Kai Hurst heading in for a feed. I think it's Kai, yes it is, Kai Hurst in for a feed. In yesterday's women's race, there was a lot of argy-bargy at the feed, lots of elbows, lots of feet, and in fact, the local hope, Kerri-Ann Payne, missed one of the feed stops because of the amount of clashes that were going on. And now, in reviewing that race, says that if she hadn't have missed that feed station, perhaps the result would have been different. She missed the bronze medal by 0.4 seconds. So it is important to get to the feed station. But Mullooly just, you know, maybe he's inexperienced in a 10-kilometre race, and knowing, you know, how to pace it, knowing how to feed, all of those kind of things may work to his disadvantage. But you look at him at the moment. I mean, the other thing is, too, is that he's used to seeing a black line on the bottom of the pool, Mullooly. You can't see anything in this serpentine. The visibility is very, very small. So you see him spending a lot of time looking up, looking around, making sure he's leading the field in the right direction.
And similar tactics employed by Eva Ristov, who emerged with a gold medal, the swimmer from Hungary in the women's event, who again was active in the pool at London 2012. She decided to go out sharply and to try and establish a lead, and she led in 5 of the 6 laps, but she just held on. It was a thrilling finish in the end, but she was caught on the run-in during the warm-up event and the qualifying event in Portugal.
The baby of the event is Ben Schult. He's only 16 years of age. He trains in Australia with Dennis Cottrell, who steered Grant Hackett and Sun Yang to successful campaigns in the 1500 at the Olympic Games. But I saw, when I went to see the swimmers earlier in the week, Benjamin's mum was there, and she came up to Kai Hurst, who is one of the more experienced in the field, and gave him a pin from Guam and said, Kai, Benjamin loves you. He thinks you're an absolute star. You're his hero. I'm giving you this pin because I want you to look after my baby. And it was just beautiful to see the interaction between the mother of a 16-year-old out there from Guam and Kai, who is himself going to become a father in November. His partner Katie is watching Kai swim, and Kai's mum's here as well. So, but it was nice to see the concern of one of the mums and the interaction with her son's hero in Kai Hurst.
Yeah, surely the 16-year-old, he won't be 17 until December, late December. Goes to school currently in Queensland in Australia. Qualified during that event in Portugal back in June.
He may end up losing contact quite quickly with the rest of the field. This pacing is quite fast. He still, though, seems like he's in the second of that group, the back part of that group. Nice high elbows from Mullooly, just stretching out nicely. You see how far his hand stretches under the water as he then starts to grab the water and pull the hand down past the body, down halfway along the leg, and then starts the recovery again. Thomas Lertz is not going to let him go. He's going to make sure that he sticks right with him. So too, our Canadian competitor,
Weinberger.
And in fact, he's sitting fairly hard on Mullooly. Daniel Fogg is still in there as well. Weinberger is from a hometown, Moose Jaw, in Canada. He goes to University of Victoria in Canada, so a lot of these boys choosing to still be students.
And another swimmer with a little bit of form, having been runner-up in that qualifier in Portugal, the FINA qualifier in June. Has the experience of the World Championship in Shanghai last year.
You see the boats there following them. One of the boats is, as we see, Weinberger a little bit closer with his technique, breathing to both sides at the moment. Mullooly doing some backstroke, so just for a couple of reasons, sussing out where everybody is, but also it just breaks up the lactic acid, the soreness, the stiffness. I don't know that he would be feeling too much of it right now, but having said that, we're about where his normal race time is, 15 minutes. 14:40 was his time in the 1500. You'll also notice on Osama Mullooly there is a lot of goo under his arms. So when you do swim a distance like 10 kilometres, your bathers or your swimming costume rubs, your underarms rub, so just the rotation, the skin from your arms onto your back. It's interesting that he's doing a lot of backstroke, so maybe he's starting just to feel a little bit of tightness into the shoulders, because changing to backstroke also just immediately releases that tightness and loosens you up. Certainly got the fitness, there's no question of that, particularly in the first 17 minutes of the race.
Lactates won't be building up just yet. It is an effortless style. Effortless is perhaps the wrong word to use, but he looks so smooth and comfortable in the water.
Well, we're coming up to our first of the laps completing. And we'll check the times and the split times. We'll keep you up to date with those.
Mullooly of Tunisia out in front. Weinberger of Canada close by, as is Fogg of Great Britain in the number 19 hat. Blue hat of Fogg of Great Britain.
Looks like Weinberger looking for line honours on the first lap. There's no gold medals awarded there, so not exactly sure why he's taking that, but he has.
Weinberger in front. Weinberger of Canada ahead of Mullooly of Tunisia. Fogg of Great Britain in third. Meyer of the United States in fourth.
18:09 for the first lap. Yesterday the girls, their first lap was 19:22. So the boys about a minute and a half faster for their first lap of what is a six lap course. As we work our way through to the tail of the field, and the Russian that decided to stand back at the start is there at number 24, 12 seconds behind.
Something we haven't really seen yet is number 22, Gianniotis of Greece. The experienced Greek swimmer is actually born in England. He was born in Liverpool. He was the Greek flag bearer at the opening ceremony. Now at his fourth Olympics, he's got an English mother. He moved to Greece when he was age three. Big Liverpool supporter, football follower.
Well, this is crowded, isn't it? Even if he was in there, it's hard to see because there are so many of them just taking up that same space. So the craft that's watching them as well, when we do get a shot, you'll notice that the lead craft, which is studying exactly what's going on there, have the referee has a yellow flag and a red flag. So in the women's race, I think there was four or five yellow flags given out. And that yellow flag is to do with contact. There is to be no unnecessary contact. Of course, it is an occupational hazard out there, but if swimmers are out there being rough intentionally, then the referee is looking for that. In fact, those three boats are looking for that.
Line of five now. Just feel that Mullooly maybe set out a statement of intent with that first lap. Just made sure everybody knew that he was about his business, and he was determined to set down a marker to the other swimmers. Started to string them out a little bit, but crossing the line at the end of the first lap, all the contenders who were being talked about previously, all the potential medalists are right up in there. Mertz and Weinberger, Fogg of Great Britain.
Well, Meyer's making a move. Backstroke swim as well, just to have a look and see. He's also got some feed tucked into his bathers, into his swimming costume. Mullooly not letting him go though, just making sure he remains. That's actually a really good place to drag, and we'll talk about that in a moment, and energy conservation out there. Here's your Greek competitor that we've just found as well. So he's up there.
Javinsky of Ukraine, another one who's started to make a move.
So our Greek friend Spiro is actually sitting just nicely in about equal third, equal fourth at the moment, wearing a black cap with the number 22 on his shoulder. So it ends up being a little bit like road cycling, where the boys will take a turn out in the front and they're doing the hardest work out in front. It's unbroken water. The whitewash that the boys are swimming in behind is actually quicker because the water's churning and it does give you a bit of drag, a bit of lift, and it makes it a little bit easier. So a good position for Osama Mululi to sit is right on around about Alex Meyer's knees, up to his waist. Meyer taking a feed, and Mululi just continues with what he's doing. No urgency at all, just the boys eyeing each other off. Potentially we could come down to a sprint finish, which if you had a sprint finish, you would probably look at someone like Mululi and his turn of pace.
Gianni Otis won the 5K last year in Shanghai, or was second rather in the 5K, won the 10 kilometer race in a time of 1:54.24. Much the same be expected here?
Yes, I would expect after seeing the girls race yesterday, that was at one hour 57 minutes. So you would think that the boys probably would be around about the 1:55, I would say.
I'll write that down now.
Oh, do I need to give you the seconds as well?
We'll be testing later.
Some great action shots of the technique of the boys. There is the open water technique of making sure you are on course, lifting the head forward. And there is the silky smooth technique of Mululi. Interesting, all through that swimming costume, Mululi has some form of lubrication to make sure that it doesn't rub.
I've seen when swimmers tackle the English Channel, when they decide to swim across the English Channel from England to France, that they always grease up, don't they, to give themselves a little bit of extra protection. And
yeah, they do. And it you know, once upon a time it was most definitely animal fat in the day and age of trying to look after the animals. I'm not sure if it's still animal fat or if it's a synthetic, but it certainly is important to make sure that you don't have a rub mark, because there is nothing worse. If it starts to rub, it will start to sting and burn, and then your mind starts to focus on that pain. Thomas Lertz doing a really good job just sitting there. He is a remarkable open water swimmer. He was voted as FINA's open water swimmer of the decade. He's coached by his brother Stefan, and he says he does about 15 kilometres in training a day. Anywhere between 15 and 20 kilometres is the usual for open water. A slight disadvantage for Thomas is that he only breathes to the left-hand side. So if it comes down to close finishes, then he won't know who's on the other side. But the other thing is too, it's a long time, 10 kilometres, to only be breathing to one side. Start to stiffen up in the shoulders and the neck.
And they need to keep relaxed in these early stages, because they know that the stress will be there on the last 200 or 400 meters of a race, even of this distance.
And as we saw with Rizdov yesterday in the women's event, you will see a change of pace with about two laps to go. Now we hear the referee's whistle, so there is contact going on somewhere in that bunched area, as we just have a look at one of the back markers.
Yeah, it's Shuli from Guam, 16 years of age. Great experience for him, however, to be part of the Olympic Games and to sample some of the events elsewhere.
Nice technique as well for our US competitor. You're looking at number 20 there, Alex Meyer. Mululi trains in the US as well. There's Vashberger and Lertz. And it's interesting, it shows you the depth, doesn't it, of swimming, to be able to have someone like Lertz in there for Germany, and then Vashberger as well for Germany. So there's two Germans, there's two Russians in the women's competition. We didn't see any double ups from a country perspective, and that could work to your advantage. You could swim as a group, but at the moment the Russians are swimming at the group at the back end of the field, and that's not going to help them get into the medals.
field is beginning to take some shape now. We touched on Gianniotis of Greece, and the other swimmer who started to come to the fore now is Clary of Italy. He was fourth in Beijing 4 years ago. Male Open Water Swimmer of the Year back in 2010. Another one who featured at the World Championships over 10K and 25 kilometres last year.
Sauvage, our French competitor, just off to the left-hand side of the screen there, taking a slightly different line to the other boys. A little bit lonely out there, and certainly not as easy as the boys would be doing it in the centre of the pack with the extra wash. There he is there. That's Julien Sauvage.
Why would he make that decision? Is it personal preference, or has he lost his bearings a little bit?
No, I think he probably wants to get into his own strokes. So the boys that are bunched up in the group would not be getting a single stroke completed without getting hit by someone. And that can be quite frustrating, just feeling like you're slipping non-stop. So for these guys, for Sauvage in particular, he's made the decision to get out of that crowd and get into some nice strokings. I mean, we have a look at these boys here. Number 10. And that's Vashberger. And not so much number 12, with it, which is Thomas Lertz. He's in a pretty good position, but certainly those boys sitting just in behind the feet of Mullooly and Maya, they're not getting into strokes. They're just getting kicked or hit. We see the referee about to blow his whistle, and the yellow flag is up. Not sure if we'll get a shot of the board to see what number it is that has the yellow flag. Getting quite close to the spectators. It's a great venue for interaction. It's not usual or normal for open water or marathon swimming. Normally they're in locations that you get a glimpse of them every now and again, but for this it's a circular course and you get to see them the whole way through, which is fantastic.
It is one of the free events at London 2012. Anybody who wants to come into the park this morning can actually do so and see the action.
So a yellow card has been given. Nothing to concern the swimmers.
Two distinct groups emerging. Swimmers approaching another feed station.
You'll see them position themselves into that feed station, and that was probably a mistake that Kerri-Anne Payne yesterday made. She tried to get across a group of swimmers into the feed station, but then we saw Hayley Anderson, whose coach Catherine Voigt gave her very specific instructions to not miss a feed, to make sure she gave the feed the respect that it needed. So Mullooly is coached by the same open water coach, Dave Salo's squad at USC Trojans. As you see Mullooly swimming almost every stroke with his head up to try and judge where he can get into for that feed. But Catherine Voigt is in charge of the longer distances for those guys. So she would have told Mullooly the same instructions. Get the feed, make sure you get it in. In the first opportunity of the feed station on lap one, we only saw one competitor, Kai Hurst, take in feed. Oh, somebody's lost their feed already out of their pole.
Flags to identify the individual requirements of each of these swimmers in the men's 10-kilometre marathon. Second lap of six. Tunisian flag of Mellouli, already a medalist in the 1500 metres in the pool.
Various things in the bottles or the cups, depending on what the athlete wants. On the start line, we did see them have some things tucked into their swimming costumes. Mellouli gets his feed, so too Maya. So at the moment, they're just going for electrolytes, so it's just a replenishing drink. One athlete also choosing to get rid of the cap as well, so we'll keep you updated once we see that swimmer without the cap. I just saw him throw it off. So obviously it's heating up a little bit out there at 21 degrees in the water.
That was impressive by Meyer, the way that he was able to take his bottle, empty that bottle as well in a couple of strokes and then be on his way. It is Maya of the United States and Maloui, who are the two in front, Maloui of Tunisia.
Recap of the busyness of the feed station.
One of the Russians who got a real buffeting, I think you're an elbow in the side of the head as he tried to take on board some fluid.
I'm sure he'll give some back if he needs to. For those that are worried as well about the bottles and paraphernalia that's been thrown out by the swimmers into the Serpentine, it does get cleared up each lap, and also at the end of the event they make sure that there's nothing left there that could be harmful to the environment.
It is a grueling event, isn't it? And as you say, sometimes brutal.
Now this is where Maloui will feel very uncomfortable. He hasn't had very much experience with open water or marathon swimming, so the clash of arms, the clash of legs, the invasion of your space. For pool swimmers, it's all about having your own space. It does get aggressive in warm-up of pool competitions, but nothing like this. So for Maloui, a couple of things that I think he will feel very uncomfortable with: the close company and the contact and the lack of a black line as well.
But the distance won't be a worry given the amount of time that he spends in the pool and the training that he does.
And also the kilometres that he's got in the bank. I mean, he's been doing this for so long. You know, every year he would have been doing at least, you know, 46, 48 weeks a year of hard training, doing anywhere up to 100, 120 kilometres a week, or less now that he's a little bit older. He has had injuries in the past to Summer Maloui. He's had back and shoulder injuries, but seems to be fairly clear of those these days. You know, that distance that are in the arms, it's something that the body remembers.
So probably looking at a split time of what, 36:30 for the end of the second lap, given that the first was completed in 1809 by Weinberger, the Canadian, who was in front at that stage. If only just from Maloui, who led them out and stayed in front for most of the opening 1.7 kilometres.
So we've probably got about another 2.5 minutes, 3 minutes before they get to that timing. So we see our Canadian competitor, Weinberger, taking the lead over, but Maloui never far away. He's always been right there. Alex Meyer, happy, the American, just to sit back now and let somebody else do a turn on the front. Haven't seen a shot of Kai Hurst, who has some extensive experience in open water. He is one of Australia's most successful Ironmen, and that is a surf life-saving sport where you compete in board paddling, ski paddling, swimming. He is the most decorated surf lifesaver or Ironman in Australia. So he probably prefers Kai Hurst if there was a bit of a wave out there. I know Thomas Lertz has said the same thing, that he excels in choppy conditions, and these conditions are like swimming in a very big swimming pool without the same walls. Oh, I just see the loping stroke of Kai Hurst now. So he's sitting just in behind, I think, Thomas Lertz from Germany.
There's the other German competitor, Weinberger.
Oh, here's a recap of that yellow flag. Hopefully we get to see it was number one.
There was Chavinsky of Ukraine who was yellow carded, or yellow flagged, I should say.
Well, not a lot in it. Nobody really making a move. There's Kai Hurst, number four, just sitting beside Thomas Lertz on the top part of the screen. Competitor just having a bit of a stop. Something going on at the back there. Well, look at that. It's almost like synchronized swimming, isn't it?
Five at the head of the field. Number 10 on the near side is Weinberger.
Maloui struggling here. He's just struggling to get his stroke, struggling with the fact that there was close quarters with the others. He just stopped for a second just to readjust his position. And Weinberger just deciding he's going to pick up the pace a little bit just to see what the others have got. There will be spurts of speed. There'll be breakaways, like you see in road cycling, but the important thing is not to let them get away.
Weinberger with Meyer of the United States for company.
Also sitting there, as well. Thomas Lertz is in there.
Mar is the current United States open water champion over 10 kilometers, studying at Harvard.
So a good swimmer and smart. Well, you'll need to be smart to win this race because tactics do play a big part. And having a strong mind as well. Here we come. We'll get an idea of how much they've picked it up or whether or not they've stayed at the same pace. With the women, we saw them pick it up after the third lap. So we're just coming to the conclusion of the second lap.
Weinberger at the end of the first lap was clocked at 18:09.2.
Well, it's considerably slower. That's interesting. 19:04 for the lap. So almost a whole minute slower. So that just indicates that they're playing the game with each other. They're racing off each other's pacing. Nobody having the courage to get going and pick it up. But it is early stages.
You can see there that there's nothing between them at all. Around 7 seconds difference between the first 20 or so as they went through at the end of the second lap.
Oh, Weinberger taking out honours for the first of the two laps, which is interesting that he's motivated obviously by that. You can see him leading now, quite definitely picking it up to go through that timing device. Formation a little bit of an arrow shape at the moment. Lead swimmer just out there by himself. And then the rest of them following. A couple losing contact now. As the distance goes on, really does show out who's done enough work for a 10-kilometre race and who maybe has just been turning the arms over and not doing the same kind of work.
Jenny Otis in fourth place as they went through at the end of the second lap.
Kai Hurst in fifth, just beside him. Mullooly got through in sixth. So the big names that have the pacing when they want it in the final stages are right there. Lertz was there as well. He's just there in eighth.
Two really were adrift. Shuli from Guam and Diachin of Russia. Gap between Diachin and the leaders was just over 18 seconds. Everybody else tightly compacted, just around 9 seconds between the leader and the rest of the field. Apart from that, those final two, Diachin and Shuli.
Well, the interesting thing about our lead competitor in reading some of his comments prior to coming out and racing, of all things for a swimmer and an open water or marathon swimmer to be scared of, he has a fear of deep water. Now, the edges of the Serpentine aren't particularly deep, but there are spaces out there that are quite deep. You often find that with swimmers, that they have a fear of water, a fear of deep water, a fear of scuba diving, those kind of things, because they're used to that control of having the pool, a particular depth, 3 meters in depth now in the main competition pool, and the black line. So Weinberger admitting that he has a fear of deep water.
Sometimes a way to conquer your demons, though, isn't it? Admitting to the
head on
the fear, yeah. Recreational lake that was created in Hyde Park way back in the 18th century. It is relatively shallow. It was created after the damming of the River Westbourne in Hyde Park. Kensington Gardens and Hyde Park landscapes.
I was also reading that obviously water quality has been of concern in the lead up to this. They did do a lot of work between the warm-up swim last year and this swim for the London 2012 Games. The water quality has been approved and it is okay. But they did need to top up some water, so they needed to make sure that the water they were topping it up with was also of the right quality. We don't want athletes getting sick from swimming in something like this, which it has happened at venues around the world. But I did notice Hayley Anderson said after the swim, the women's swim, that it didn't taste too good. So obviously no chlorination out there to make it taste okay.
Well, the triathletes and presumably the open water swimmers, they all will say that maybe an old wives' tale, I don't know, that they'll take on board a cola drink afterwards because they say that it gives them insulation against the bugs in the water.
Exactly. I know when I used to swim open water swims, in one of the most iconic places I swam in was the Yarra River in Melbourne in Australia, which is the river that they say runs upside down. It's not a particularly clean river. And in fact, the swim that I did 2 years in a row, they now no longer have the swim because of the water quality. My dad made me drink castor oil before I started racing just to line my stomach so nothing would get in. I don't know if it was very good advice, to be honest. There's a clash of arms, so another yellow card's just been given out, I think. We'll see soon. Definitely a referee's whistle as we see the beautiful technique of Osama Mululi, who is not struggling by any means with this race at the moment, perhaps struggling with the close quarters and the company. So maybe he needs to make the decision to actually just go. Just give himself some clear space, start to pick the pace up a little bit, see what the rest of them have. And if we get a tighter shot, I reckon that's what he's done. Mululi's just taken off a little bit to give himself some clear space.
Could you create an identikit swimmer for an event such as this in terms of height and weight and swimming experience, to have the speed of the pool and the stamina and the endurance needed to cope with the distances, whether it be 5, 10 or 25 kilometres?
I'll tell you what their name is when they win the gold medal at the end. Look, you can, but you know, for all the talent identification that particular countries do, there's something that you can't talent ID for, and that's toughness, it's courage. And sometimes just having that X factor, you know, often it's not a particularly nice term, but often they call it the mongrel factor, you know, being able to just fight your way out and having just that little bit more that everybody else is looking for. And sometimes you're just born with that. And Mululi showed that in 2008, where he came up against Grant Hackett in the 1500 freestyle. Hackett was looking for a third consecutive 1500 title at Olympic competition. No man at the stage had done that. And Mululi just broke his heart. He went out absolutely flat out and swam a very fast time under the 14:40 mark. And Hackett just couldn't keep with him. So whether or not he's going to try and do the same to these competitors, to try and just break their heart in lap number 3. So at the end of this lap, we'll be coming up to the halfway point. Not too far away from the feed station, which Mululi will need to be taking on some food. Some of the boys just choosing to wear just the pants and a bare back and bare stomach. Personal preference. Of course, from a drag point of view, having a suit covering your chest is quicker. We found that when they had the full suits allowed for that 18-month period in swimming where we broke something, or the swimmers broke something like 220 world records, which is just phenomenal. Mululi just dragging his legs, no urgency, breathing only at the moment to that left-hand side. And you look at the difference in technique from Mululi to Lurtz, where you can see he's really trying. His stroke costs him a lot more energy. And then Feinberger sitting in behind Thomas Lurtz. This is where there was a bit of interaction. This is where Mululi decided that he was going to get out of this pack. Just wasn't getting his stroke in. Clash of arms, clash of legs. We heard the referee blow the whistle. There's Daniel Fogg. He's in there as well. Still in the replays at this stage. We'll join the live pictures now. We'll get you an idea as to who is where as Mululi starts to set the pace just a little bit quicker.
They're in single file now. And there you can see the yellow flag is issued to what appears to be the swimmer in the number 7 hat. Confirm that for you shortly. So, Hordar of Spain, who's 17. Metvalli of Egypt, who's 7.
It's hard to know which one of the two. So, Lurtz, Weinberger. There's Kai Hurst. Nice positioning for Kai Hurst. Number 4 on his back, but also in there is Varsberger. Daniel Fogg, is that him at number 19? Yes, it is. So he's just dropped off that front pack a little bit.
That injection of pace has opened the race up.
Yeah, these guys really going to struggle to stay in contact with this lead group. We'll very soon see some distinct packs. And in that formation that we see, I reckon we'll probably end up with about four distinct packs out of it. Out of the way, Birdie.
Yep. Another of the Moorhens, the Hyde Park Moorhens, is ushered away by the flapping arms of Mullooly.
Look at that. Nice high elbows, really relaxed with his technique.
Well, the whole complexion of the race has changed within 5 minutes, isn't it? Mullooly just deciding to inject some pace after the completion of the second lap. The pace had dropped considerably, as you mentioned, Nicole, during the second lap, but now he's taking it on and he's determined to break one or two of these.
Giannottis is in there as well, sitting right beside Kai Hurst, so they're quite crowded and the pace is very, very fast. So even at this stage, with the pacing that Mullooly is setting, the likes of Kai Hurst, Giannottis, they're just not keeping up at the moment. And just that lead pack of probably three swimmers at the moment, Kai desperate to try and stick into that. I reckon this lead pack's going to have five in it, like the women did. Although, like Eva Rissov, we might actually see Osama Mullooly just setting it. He's just going a little bit too close to the edge there. Going to have to come back in a little bit to get around this can or this boy. Now, this is the big thing for Mullooly, because he just doesn't have that experience of direction. Hasn't got the onboard GPS tuned, finely tuned, like some of them. And then the crowd follows. So it's a danger for them. You can see he's definitely coming around now.
I'm sure that he'll want to take on board some fluid and to get an energy bar or to take one of the energy gels on board to make sure that he's fully prepared for the second half of the race.
Great crowd. It's a beautiful day again in London. Had a couple of days of warm weather, and I must say that the weather gods have been very, very kind to London 2012, where the locals talk about a lot of rain and unpredictable weather. We haven't had too much rain, and the weather has been quite good in terms of the conditions for athletes for peak performance, and today is no different. A beautiful day.
And the appetite of this crowd, whetted by the women's 10-kilometer race yesterday and the two triathlons which were held here last weekend. Thrilling finish to the women's event, just as there was in the 10K yesterday. Women's triathlon and the 10K marathon swim won by Eva Rissov of Hungary, who decided to get to the front early on and stay in front. Now it's Mullooly who leads out the men. Gold and bronze medal winner in the pool.
Looking for his feed station.
There is the Tunisian.
Oh, nicely done. He got that all down. Beautifully done.
And that's quite reassuring, I imagine, as he heads off again.
Weinberger didn't look like he took his feed, but didn't take the time that Mullooly took. And he's got just a little lead at the moment. And I'm sure Mullooly, if he wants to, well, he's closed it already. Daniel Fogg just sitting in there behind Mullooly with the blue cap.
Weinberger, who won the warm-up event in Hyde Park last year, the London Invitational, beat Thomas Lurtz by 26 seconds, but you can never rule out Lurtz, who's got this fantastic record in 5 and 10-kilometre races, in open water races. He says his motto is never give up, and that mentality, that toughness necessary in the distance events like this one.
Well, Mullooly there on the right of screen. Weinberger still holding on. It's a good performance by the Canadian. Finished 17th at the World Championships last year. Did the World Championships of 2010 and finished 13th. So great pacing from the Canadian. Well, there's the breaking of the groups. And surprisingly, despite the pace, the backmarkers of that first group are still holding on. Referees watching with a keen eye to make sure that, as we hear the whistle, as Mullooly goes into the backstroking arms once again. I think that is more just about breaking up the tension and the tightness in the shoulders from doing just this constant freestyle stroking. It's a great body position. You can see all of his back. You can see his bottom coming out of the water as well. That just means that he's really sitting high in the water. If you didn't have that same good body position, then you know you would almost look as though you were sinking a little bit and only the arms are coming out. And we see that a little bit with the other swimmers, that you can't see the clarity of the whole back out of the water.
So economical. Mullooly of Tunisia leading the field in the men's 10-kilometre swim marathon. This is the third of six laps of the Serpentine in Hyde Park. Crowds on the banks, 5 and 6 deep yet again. Weinberger keeping Mullooly company. Weinberger, who has won in the Serpentine already, did so in August of last year, the swimmer from Canada. Fog of Great Britain close behind.
Clash of arms, change of direction around the buoy. Done fairly easily for these guys. A little bit crowded in the midsection there.
See number 18 go through there as well, Diachin of Russia. Former open water swimmer of the year, but perhaps better suited to even more than 10 kilometres, 25k. That is a marathon.
It is. Canada winning a couple of medals as we see our baby of the field, 16-year-old Guam athlete, taking on his feed station. Canada won a couple of medals in the pool, one of them being Brent Hayden in the 100 metres freestyle, the second shortest distance on the swimming program. Wasn't a particularly great Olympic Games in the swimming pool for Canada. I think for a while they've been in that official rebuilding phase.
Weinberger certainly got some good years ahead of him at the age of 22. Still at university, coached by Ron Jacks. And runner-up in the FINA qualifier for London 2012 swim in Portugal in June.
Well, this will be a sensation in Canada if he can win. They've only won one gold medal so far at the Olympic Games, 16 in total in medals.
Haven't been able to pick out Stoichev yet, the record holder for the cross-channel swim between England and France.
What race number is he? Start to see if we can find him.
Stoichev is 14, the Bulgarian.
Okay.
Veteran now at the age of 35.
It's more crowded than I expected it to be coming up to the halfway point. I thought that somebody would make a move as we see the timing coming up. But quite often if they're racing, say, a 1500 in the pool, they do break it up into 3 500-metre blocks. So potentially here the breakup with coach's instructions would be per lap. So maybe it's the halfway point that Mullooly has been told by Dave Salo or Catherine Boyd to make a move. Line honours for lap 3. Looking as though it's going to go to Weinberger. He's making a bit of a sprint for the line.
Weinberger of Germany, number 10. Looking to lead the swimmers through the halfway point.
Has been a pretty calm race for the referee to oversee. Hasn't been too much going on from the above water level. I'm sure there's plenty going on underwater though.
Weinberger of Germany, Mullooly of Tunisia. Mertz of Germany in third place. Weinberger of Canada in there as well. Saavedra of Venezuela.
Well, they have picked up the pace. Not quite as fast as the first lap. which was 18 minutes and 9 seconds. This lap is around the 18:30 mark. But that second lap was 19:04. So it's almost a 30-second pickup of pace for lap number 3. I wonder how Mullooly's feeling right about now.
Well, he did up the pace. I sense that he wanted to try and shift a few of those off his shoulder to ensure that he had a little bit of clear water between him and the rest. But the more experienced performers, the swimmers who you might expect to be challenging for a medal have stayed with him. They weren't fazed by the pace that Mullooly was able to put into the race.
It's actually a nice position for Mullooly to be in, just to sit on the back of Vashverger's feet, get a little lift for a little while, take the energy out of his racing. And here are our boys. Number 12, Thomas Lertz. Number 21, Weinberger.
And Saavedra of Venezuela, another one who's started to make a move. Number 13. That is Stoichev, right on cue, number 14.
We found him. Well, Meyer's in there as well. He's making sure he's keeping contact with the leaders. And Giannotis is in there as well. Daniel Fogg, top of the screen, is there, number 19. So not a bad performance for him. And our Japanese competitor as well, Hirai, is just sitting in that group. It's actually a very good performance by these guys to maintain contact with these lead swimmers. Prinz Lu trains at University of Georgia, although representing South Africa. He's swimming for the Mardi Bulldogs.
Yeah, comes from Durban. Another one who's transferred successfully from the pool, a Commonwealth bronze medalist 6 years ago. Also competed at the Olympics in Beijing.
So the pace being turned up by Vashverger. But having a look around, almost like when you watch the road cycling when the cyclists call through the back markers, Vashverger just turning around to say, come on guys, who else is there? Who's going to take a turn now? Looks like it's costing him a fair bit of energy as well. Quite red in the face. You can see he's really, through the veins, through the neck, really exerting himself. But it's working so far. A little bit of clean water for him. Mullooly just maintaining contact.
Vashverger of Germany in front, followed by Mullooly of Tunisia. Doubling up at the Games of 2012.
Well, the Germans were not very successful in the pool at all for the aquatics program. In fact, I can't think of a medal that they won during the competition. Certainly no gold. Britta Steffen was their great hope. She did not get there. Paul Biedermann, their 400 freestyle, 200 freestyle world champion, world record holder, did not get there. So too early to call it just after the halfway mark, but if a German could win, that would be their first gold medal of swimming in 2012.
Would Vashverger and Lertz have talked tactics beforehand? Well, given each other a lead and some indication of what their race plans would have been and whether or not they could help each other out?
They do have an advantage of having two of them in there, so only two countries with multiple competitors. So that does give them an advantage, but I don't know. Whether or not, I mean, you saw at the start of the race that a couple of the Russian boys in particular just decided to sit back. I have to have a look at where the second German is. I don't think we've got to the advanced stage of having a domestic like they do in road cycling, somebody to do the work in the opening stages. And I did note that started to play a prominent role as well in the triathlon, in particular the women's triathlon, where somebody sets the pace early and then just drops off and sacrifices their own results for that of their team. You want to get the pacing right, wouldn't you, if you're paddling a board out there? You wouldn't want to go too slow and get in the way.
Vashberger of Germany, followed by Mullooly of Tunisia, then the shaven head of Weinberger of Canada.
So coming around this end buoy, which brings them closer to the feed station, starting to get more important, the feed station. Sure, the smell of the barbecue from the cafe that's just there that we just see will be skimming across the water. That's the thing about the sport of swimming, you can actually smell what's going on outside. It sits right on the water's level.
It's usually hot chocolate that they're after the Serpentine Swimming Club have their Christmas Day swim. Members of the Serpentine Swimming Club are allowed into the lake between 6 and 9:30 every morning.
That'd be
and they
a bit
will
chilly.
Even break the ice in the depths of winter to make sure that they keep up that tradition.
Yep, you would have to be fairly committed to do that, I would say. Probably some other adjectives come to mind rather than committed.
But they do it.
And they love it. And I'm sure they're looking on at these events being held in their water with a certain amount of pride. Probably setting some new records too for the Serpentine Swimming Club. Mullooly, he's just like a shark, just sitting there waiting, just waiting. So just turning up the heat a little bit is Usama Mullooly from Tunisia, a country that's probably better known for Star Wars movies than their achievements in swimming. But Mullooly changed that in 2008, winning the gold medal in the 1500. Could this be a second gold medal for him? The first African swimmer to win a gold medal individually at the Olympic Games in swimming. There he is with number 25. Vashberger from Germany in number 10, just taking some backstroke strokes, assessing the field, counting the numbers, also just changing up the fatigue a little bit. He's working really hard at the front there, Vashberger. He's almost working so hard that he's losing his cap a little bit.
It's not distress that you're seeing, but it's not as economical, is it, as Mullooly, who looks very smooth and very comfortable through the water.
It's interesting though, sometimes those smooth swimmers can be a little bit deceptive in terms of the energy cost. You may have seen or may have caught Sun Yang from China race the 1500. He broke the world record, almost broke the 1430 barrier, which is an amazingly fast swim. But for the first 1300 metres, it looked like he was just giving a masterclass on technique, dragging his legs, and he really only started to swim fast in the last 200. But the pace he was holding, I'm sure it was costing him a lot energy-wise. So sometimes those really good technicians can be a little bit deceiving in terms of the cost. A lot of hard work going on out here in terms of trying to get a full stroke in, not being able to stretch out at all. Because if you stretch out, you're going to suddenly cop a foot in the face, which Kerry-Anne Payne experienced quite a few times in the women's race. There's Daniel Fogg, number 19. Kai Hurst was the one that threw his cap off. He's number 4, so losing that cap. Well, they're still right there, aren't they? This is amazing.
Could develop into a really thrilling conclusion. Mullooly of Tunisia, we know that he's got the pool speed, 1500 meters gold medalist 4 years ago, a bronze this time around. He hasn't been able to shake off Vashberger, and there's a platoon of swimmers just behind him.
Doing a good job with direction though, Mullooly, as we see in this super slow-mo. All of the boys having that open water or marathon swimming technique of looking up, breathing to the side, but then also looking up to make sure that the direction is the right direction. Good technique too.
Well, who's flying in the pool or in the open water that we've got? At the moment, it's Vashberger of Germany, Mullooly of Tunisia, just alongside. In the chasing group, we've seen Lurtz now. We've seen the swimmer from Bulgaria. Swam the English Channel in a record 6 hours 57 back in 2007. The 35-year-old from Sofia.
Well, we'll get an idea soon enough in terms of pacing. Feed station all important as well. Not a lot for the referee to be blowing his whistle about. Look how close they are to the crowd. And it is quite shallow there. You can see the water lapping up on the edge. If they do hit shallow water, they are allowed to stand, but they're not allowed to jump or move forward with their legs. They must go straight back down and start swimming again.
One of the swims at the World Championship in Rome was abandoned halfway through for that very reason, where a swimmer was drifted because of the change of the tide, because it was offshore.
And when you say halfway through, it was 14k into a 25k race.
So they had to do it all again 2 days later.
You would have been heartbroken, particularly if you were leading.
Well, there were some safety considerations because the boys were being blown onto the shore as well. That's not an issue today.
Plenty to contend with normally as well in the spaces of water that are chosen. 2007 World Swimming Championships, they had the same issues. It was held in Port Phillip Bay, and the boys were being blown away pre-competition. But then jellyfish were one of the things that they had to contend with as well. A few fish in there. Thomas Lertz made the comment pre-race that he likes fishing. He's pretty good at spotting different species as well. Though I don't think he's spending too much time out there. He's concentrating on pacing and trying to make sure that he can keep contact with Varshberger and Mullooly.
And how aware will they be of the crowd? And will they glimpse any of those flags which are being draped over the hoardings?
Depends on how their mental state is. If they need it, they'll see it. If they don't, they'll be focusing. Eyes open definitely right now, looking for this feed station. But in the other 1.65 kilometres of the lap course, they would, for a lot of the time, have their eyes closed, just grimacing, trying to get through.
See if we can pick out the flags. The Tunisian flag is being lowered towards the surface of the water.
Nicely done by Varshberger. Really good feed. Mullooly got a good feed as well.
Maya going through that.
Guy Hurst in there as well. Got a good feed. And Saavedra is there as well. He's our Venezuelan swimmer. A lot of the families of the swimmers, if they haven't been able to get tickets into the stands of this amazing venue, they have actually been parking themselves at this boathouse coffee shop since early hours to make sure that they get a good spot to see their family.
Mullooly, Varshberger, Lertz and Weinberger, the first four.
When you're talking about looking for support from the crowd or the flags that are hanging over the barricades there at that feed station, not only are they looking for their feed, but they're also looking for some feedback as well from the coaches. The coach is standing there yelling instructions, yelling encouragement. Not a lot of time, so it would be very quick.
But will the coach be able to get a proper overview of the race?
From that position where they are, well, you know, in a lot of races they actually are allowed to be out and craft. In past they have been allowed to be out paddling as well. But from that position, it's a pretty good course to be able to see actually. You know, from the position of that feed pontoon, they can see right along, but sometimes it's just a flash of arms.
Varshberger of Germany, he is the leader at the moment. The police officer, now 25 years of age. He's coached by Hans Wedense. The other German in the field, Thomas Lertz, is coached by his brother Stefan and has been since 2005, the most successful swimmer in the field, the 32-year-old from Würzburg. Bronze medalist 4 years ago.
Well, coming around to the turning boys at the bottom part of the course, and as they turn around here, they will be heading their way back to the timing device for the conclusion of lap four. Hope they've kept count. It's a long race, isn't it? 10 kilometres. It's called marathon swimming here at the Olympic Games. Normally at World Championships, it's called open water. They've called it marathon swimming at the Olympic Games because obviously the timing of it is very similar to the marathon for track and field or athletics.
So we should perhaps be looking at 1 hour 13 or thereabouts when they come to the end of the fourth lap.
Well, we're starting to see a little bit of a breakaway. So it looks as though there's about 4 to 5 athletes that are in a straight line, and then there's that bunch. So 4 athletes and then the pack.
Test of mental strength in so many ways. The need to fight the hurt that they will be feeling in the closing stages, and also to have the belief that even if you're 20 or 30 meters behind at this stage, you can still keep up and you can still keep on the heels of the leaders.
Yeah, sometimes it can be heartbreaking as we see the second group that's really trying to maintain contact. And Kudinov from Kazakhstan is in there as well. First time we've seen him in that main bunch. Kai Hurst is also there as number 4. Without a cap on. Well, like the marathon where they talk about the point in time where your mind starts to overtake, I mean, this is really getting into that danger period as well. They start to feel every niggle, every pain, the exertion. Things will be getting into their head. And it's the tough ones that have that mental fortitude to be able to just block it out and think of the positives. Great stroke rating from our lead swimmer, Vashberger, really stroking quite fast.
Stoichev of Bulgaria in the chasing group, and so to Kudinov of Kazakhstan. Had a haul of gold medals when he represented Russia over 25K at the World Championships. Another of the veterans really in this field, another one who's swum the channel and swum in a similar time to Stoichev.
This is amazing, just that they're all still so close at the completion of lap 4. Well, there's the finishing that you can see just at the bottom of the screen with the board. It's a similar arch with the Omega timing.
So 4 down, 2 to go. Vashberger in front. Vashberg of Germany, followed now by Weinberger. Malouli of Tunisia is third. Giannotis of Greece in fourth place. Lertz of Germany. Savage of France is there. And Stoichev has made his move, the Bulgarian.
Really, it's the top 20 or so that are just still all right there. To make up that distance in a short period of time is quite difficult in a sport like swimming when you're playing in the water. But that lap time was 8 minutes and 31 seconds, so very similar to the lap time of lap number 3. Daniel Fogg, the local hope, is just in that third group there. So these last two laps, as we saw in the women's race, is where they'll start to really spread out. The turn of pace will start to increase. Only breathing off to one side, looking forward as well. So only breathing off to the left-hand side is Vashberger. Swimmers do have a personal preference of which side they breathe to. As you learn as a kid, you do get taught to breathe to both sides, but one side traditionally does feel more comfortable than the other. It is better for long-term injury prevention if you are breathing to both sides, just for spreading out the workload of your neck and your shoulders. As you can see that Vashberger is quite lopey with his stroke, almost looking under his arm when he breathes as well, focusing on the top 3 there. Weinberger with number 21. Mullooly, who has not lost contact or been out of the top three for the whole race, still sitting there, just lurking.
Gianni Otis, number 22, just on the extreme left of your picture. Joined by Lurz of Germany, Savage of France, another one who's in there. Stoichev of Bulgaria, the 35-year-old.
Looks as though Savage has got rid of his cap as well, the French swimmer, number 6. He's now swimming without that distinctive French cap. So that would be a heat factor, getting a little bit hot, a little bit overworked out there. Well, that's a surprise from an Australian and a Great Britain perspective. There is Daniel Fogg and Kai Hurst, so sitting well back at the moment. Fogg went through at that last turn at equal 22nd, and Kai Hurst from Australia went through in 20th. Keep in mind there was only 25 starters. See, Mullooly very relaxed with the hand. The little finger and the thumb is the first entry point for the recovery process to finish, to go into the water with the hand.
And those are skills that he would have been introduced to as soon as he got into a pool and had the right type of coaching from an early age.
And it's all about technique, Tony. And, you know, quite often as a young swimmer's moving through their career, technique is not something that's focused on. It's the laps up and down. And that's when injury takes place. That's when a swimmer doesn't stay in to the time that they can fulfill some amazing feats in their career. So it's important to make sure that you have correct technique. Otherwise, you're not being efficient and you'll end up getting injuries. So to have a good coach that has an eye for technique, but also has the energy to actually focus on technique during long training sessions of 2, 2.5, 3 hours. Sometimes the coaches won't focus on that. They'll just write the program on the board and away the swimmer goes, and there's not a lot of interaction. But the good coaches are trying to give the swimmers feedback. As an example for technique, there's great training centres all throughout the world, but one of the main training centres in Australia is the Australian Institute of Sport in the capital of Australia, Canberra. They've built a new swimming complex that has something like 30 cameras around the pool, and they have instant feedback. They have television screens all around the pool, and what they can do is they can film the swimmer in isolation, and the coach will be saying, I want you to work on this particular technique in your stroke. It may be a small change, and anyone that plays sport, particularly golf is a good analogy, it's really difficult to change your golf swing, very difficult to change your swimming stroke. But the feedback, the instant feedback with the cameras at the AIS and the system, is that they can put the swim on delay. So you can delay it by up to 10 or 20 or 30 seconds, whatever your choice is. The swimmer can do their 2 laps, stop, and then watch themselves on delay. So they can actually see whether or not they are actually making the changes in technique. So that's one of the world leaders with that particular facility. But great facilities, legacy facilities in Beijing. The US have got wonderful facilities. You know, right around the world, it's starting to make a difference.
That must be a challenge for a coach of a distance swimmer like this, keeping it interesting.
Yeah.
Just doing something slightly different, just trying to keep the motivation there.
You know, it's interesting. One of the most common asked questions is, what do you think about when you do swimming training? Because from the outside, it looks quite boring and monotonous, and you don't have the same interaction as if you're going for a run, training for a marathon, where you can talk to your mates. But the really good swimmers in training, as boring as it sounds, they're actually thinking about their technique every single stroke that they take. There'll be something they're working on. I'm trying to undersell it a little bit, aren't I? It's still quite a social sport. A conversation that may take 5 minutes on dry land can take 2 hours to complete in between repetitions in the training pool, which is quite entertaining. But it is a potential to let your mind wander, but the good swimmers, they're focusing. Look at this. I cannot comprehend that they're still all so close this far into the race.
They're making a splash in every respect in Hyde Park. It's been enthralling, really has, as was the women's race yesterday where we had that thrilling sprint finish. Now we'd have a similar conclusion to the men's race.
Well, Mullooly trying, I think. You can see just a little, like we saw with Iva Rizdov yesterday, you can just see a little more white water around Mullooly's stroke. That means that he's starting to pick up the velocity. the energy is starting to lift. So Mullooly is right now trying to make a break. So good tactics, trying to get a clean feed as well, which is going to come up at the feed station very soon. But Mullooly is picking it up. Can they go with him? Will he be able to maintain the pickup of pace for long enough to be able to break the hearts of the rest of them?
Mullooly of Tunisia kicking on. Weinberger of Canada with the shaved head close by. Vashberger of Germany, who's led them through the last three laps.
It's the other question to ask too, is can he sustain? If he goes now, he gets a good feed in with a lap and a half to go, is it too early? Or can he sustain that pace? I don't have any answers to the questions I'm posing. It's all going to unfold before our eyes as we finish watching the marathon swim. But he is definitely starting to move.
And will there be any doubts in his mind, given that he is relatively inexperienced over this particular distance?
I guess this course, the advantage with the course that they've set for London 2012 is, from a directional point of view, you can't make too much of a mistake. So that's going to be one of the bonuses. But Vashberger desperately trying to hold on to the feet of Osama Mullooly. Look at the stroke rating on Thomas Lertz. He's going with him as well. He knows that this is the break. He's experienced enough, Lertz, to know that Mullooly is trying to take a race-winning break.
Lertz has been able to go with him, as has Weinberger and Vashberger. The Canadian and the German, the two Germans in there.
A lot of energy in Lertz's stroke as well. He looks back, sees who's behind him. As I said, he only breathes to one side. Lertz. Spiros, he's sitting in there as well. He had the honour, a great honour, of being the original torchbearer as the London 2012 torch made its way from Olympia in Greece at the Temple of Hera. He was the original runner, the first runner. What an amazing experience for any Olympian.
Greek spinner who was born in England, born in Liverpool.
Diachin is there as well, Diachin. And Vashberger has just backed off now. The pace has just been turned up that little bit. Ah, this is the shot that we wanted. Let's see what Mullooly's done. Well, he has half a body length, maybe a body length, on Thomas Lertz.
Lertz, who finished third 4 years ago. Clary of Italy was fourth on that occasion. Lertz and Clary both in this race. Dividen of the Netherlands retiring after the games in 2008. David Davis of Great Britain was the silver medalist then.
A competitor from Egypt, just at the tail of the field. And in fact, I think our baby of the competition, Benjamin from Guam, is still past that. Hopefully he's still going. That'll be the big challenge for the 16-year-old from Guam to actually complete the course, even though he's a fair way behind.
The split at the end of the fourth lap was 6.5 minutes behind the leader, but he is still out there, Shuli.
The Egyptian swimmer, Metwali, is actually studying in the US. He goes to Southern Illinois University. There's a couple of boys in the field at that same school. So a good training partner. Lertz is holding on. He's not letting Mullooly go, but there is definite change of tactics for Osama Mullooly. He's starting to pick it up, starting to use the feet a little bit more, and there is a definite increase of velocity and speed from Mullooly. There is the timing that we just see at the bottom of the screen, which means they're not far away from the feed station. Miss a feed and it could cost you the race.
Well, this is the crucial point in the race, to ensure that you do take on some fluid, some energy drink. Who's going to get there first?
Mm-hmm. Well, Mullooly, is he going to go for, Mullooly's not going to go for a feed. Wow, controversial decision.
That's a gamble.
A huge gamble. But maybe he feels like, maybe it's inexperience, but maybe he feels like he needed to go. But the interesting thing is, nobody else took a feed either in that
yep,
group.
They've all gone. They've all gone with him. They've gone with the leader, Mullooly of Tunisia.
Lots of encouragement from the coaches on the pontoon. And in fact, not too many of them going out with the booms with the feed. So maybe it was an instruction or a direct tactic not to take a feed on lap five.
Louis had warned that his entry into the open water elite would be memorable, and that proved to be the case. Only his second ever 10K event. He won the qualifier in Setúbal in Portugal back in June. 1 hour 45. Intended then to attack during the last couple of loops. He's employed similar tactics, we would assume, here. He admitted he probably made mistakes when he first competed over 10K in Mexico back in April, where he led for a long time and felt that he really hadn't got it left at the end of the race. So this time around, he felt it was better to pace himself through the first three or four laps and then push on. And having done it successfully in Portugal, he's decided to do the same in this Olympic final.
So putting in some very big paces. I mean, a 1500 freestyle, when you're going a 1440, which is what time Mullooly did, you know, you have a turn of speed in the first 100 of 55, 54 seconds for a 100 metres. None of the other guys have that turn of speed. But then you've also got the endurance over 1500 metres to be holding 58 seconds per 100 metres. So it is a wonderful, I guess, extra little piece to the artillery to have, that you have the speed, but you also have the endurance and the consistency of endurance.
Weinberger of Canada was the winner of the test event last August, a year ago now. Perhaps something of a surprise, because he finished more than 25 seconds ahead of Lurtz and Giannottis of Greece.
That's a big margin, very big margin. 25 seconds. We saw the women's decided by 0.4 of a second.
But again, he felt that conditions worked for him, because he said he calls himself a cold water swimmer, and he felt that the day was just right for him. And he enjoyed the setup of the course, he felt comfortable with it, and that would have given him huge confidence attacking this 10K.
Yeah, very much so coming into here. And a lot of it is about confidence.
He does admit that he hasn't got a huge amount of speed, however.
Well, Mullooly says when he races the 1500 freestyle that he backs off the pace in the penultimate 100, so 1300 to 1400 metres, so that he can save some energy for the last 100 metres. Wonder what his options in terms of playing with pace here is. You know, maybe if you're looking at a six-lap race, the fact that he let the other guys go in laps 2, 3, and 4, that was him playing with the pacing. Now you see Mullooly with the kick. Look at that kick. You see that it's a bit more of a running kick. It's about a six-beat kick with a float every now and again. Whereas at the first four laps, all we saw was him just floating his legs in a very easy two-beat kick. So two kicks for every rotation of arms. Back to that just floating kick. But every now and again, he'll just put in a big spurt.
Lurtz has stayed with him, and he was someone who wasn't entirely comfortable with the water temperature in London a year ago. He mentioned afterwards that he felt he needed to gain a bit of weight for the for the Olympic event. How much difference would that make, and why would he want to do it?
Well, there's two thought processes there. I mean, obviously Mullooly, as an example, is very trim, and his power to weight ratio is quite good. And when you're trying to pull yourself through the water, any extra weight means it's harder to move through the water. But then for a 10 kilometres, the boys can lose anywhere up to 4 or 5 kilos in weight from a hard race that is in warm conditions. 21 degrees in the water today, so they're not really warm conditions, but they'll lose a lot of weight in this race. So maybe the thought process is to beef up a little bit. It'll help him in a tight bunch if he needs to use his body weight to get through, but maybe it also gives him that little bit of energy that he needs in the final stages. Well, we now have a lead group of, I think, 4 or 5 swimmers as we come up to the timing. 4 swimmers in that group. One of them taking a feed at the back there. Let's see what Mullooly dropped in this lap. 18:31 was the last lap. 18 minutes 31. Wow, what a pickup of pace.
One lap to go. Mullooly of Tunisia in front. Pursued now by Lurz of Germany, Weinberger of Canada, and Giannotis of Greece. They are the front four. They're all chasing Mullooly of Tunisia, however. And there's a big gap to fifth place and Vashberger, who hasn't been able to stay with them.
He increased the pacing there by 45 seconds. That lap time was 45 seconds quicker, and it is now the fastest lap time. Even faster than that first lap time with the dive that was making it faster just from the pace off the dive. So 17 minutes 45 for that lap.
Terrific pace set by Mullooly. But he ignored the feeding station on that fifth lap. Part of his race strategy, but is it a risky strategy? Will he start to feel it in the closing stages? We know that he's got the pace.
And this is where course selection as well will take a place in the race. Who will win? You have to make sure that your line is correct. And you'll see that two of the boys are just slightly closer to the referee vessels. And Mullooly not spending that much time with his head up. He's putting in some really fast, hard strokes and just breathing to the side. Let's see how long it is. There's a look up. So not looking up quite as much. That could be dangerous as the other boys take a slightly different course. Just can't even see the white water of Mullooly's feet now.
Number 21. Weinberger of Canada. 22 is Giannotis of Greece. 12 is Lurz of Germany. 25, Mullooly of Tunisia.
Hopefully we'll widen up to be able to see where Mullooly is and how much the margin is as those two boys battle it out to get a clean stroke. Mullooly is in front, and look at the pacing. His elbows aren't quite as high. It's not quite the masterclass of technique now because he's not thinking about that. He's thinking about picking up the pace. His legs, his arms, his whole body would be just stinging. But certainly breaking the hearts of the rest of the athletes in terms of the pacing at the moment. Long way to go still.
Four swimmers challenging for the 3 medal places. Mullooly of Tunisia leading the way. Giannotis of Greece, who swam a couple of 400 meter races and a 1500 pool event before flying to London. He said he wanted to work hard. He wanted to get that pool speed back in his body again. He has been able to make a move and to stay with the long-term leader. Weinberger and Lurz has joined them, experienced German.
In terms of overall time, you asked me very early in the race what I thought, and I said 1 hour, 55 minutes. I mean, if he keeps, that is what I said, wasn't it? If he keeps going on the pacing, can you rub it out for me? If he keeps going on the pacing he's going now, there's no such thing as world records because all of the courses are very different. But this pacing that the boys are setting, we're looking at around about a 1 hour 50, 1 hour 51. So it's going to be exceptionally fast for the 10K. But Weinberger's trying to go with him, which is a very honourable thing to do, given that Mullooly has set quite a quick pace.
Terrific performance by Mullooly of Tunisia. Relative newcomer to the distance swimming scene. disappointed with his opening swim in Mexico back in the spring. Then he was successful at the qualifying event in Portugal. Can he follow up now with a win and a gold medal in London?
Well, the eyes of the turning boy. Last time he'll have to go around this back turning boy as they come from the side of the Serpentine. He's a little bit off course there. He needs to just head to the left. You can see that. So someone like a Daniel Fogg, who's back in this main bunch, wearing a blue cap, probably more in line with that boy, has taken the correct line. So he needs to look up. He needs to eye the boy and know where he is. Spending a lot of time just with the head down, putting in the big, fast, hard strokes.
Louis has talked himself about the need for race management. That's an aspect of the open water swims that he found difficult initially. A couple of races behind him now, and he feels confident enough, obviously, to tell the rest of the field that he's in charge and he wants that gold medal.
Nicely done. So he did make his way beautifully around the boy, so the line was good. And that gap, that's the most decisive gap we've seen the whole way through. An hour and 37 minutes.
That was Vashberger of Germany going through. Only just reached the boy. We've seen Fogg from Great Britain as well. That's the chasing group, a long way behind the four at the head of this field. Maloui of Tunisia, Lurz of Germany, Giannotis of Greece, and Weinberger in there too from Canada.
Oh, Maloui still with the big kick going. There's the gap between the first group. We've got a breakaway swimmer in the second group. But really, you could almost describe this as two groups here, as Maloui desperately tries to get as much space as he can between himself and these three swimmers. And Weinberger just trying to lead this pack. Come on, boys, let's not let him go.
Weinberger second. Giannotis of Greece is third. Lurz is currently fourth. They're in the chasing group.
So every now and again you see just the effort that Maloui's putting in with his kick. There'll be a flurry of white water. There it is. And then he just lets it drag again. So beautifully balanced, but he's not thinking about any of this now. He's thinking about, let's turn the arms over quicker. Let's get it moving. Will he take a feed? Doesn't seem to be a long way to go. If you've gone an hour and 39 minutes and there's only 10, 12 minutes to go. Well, this will be a sensation. First time he's attempted open water or marathon swimming and pool swimming. He wins a bronze medal in the 1500 freestyle at the Olympic Games in London 2012. Can he win gold at his first attempt for doing the marathon and 1500?
Time of 17:45. That was the split for his fifth lap, his fifth lap of six around the Serpentine in the centre of London.
And we're now 8 minutes into this last lap.
And still it's with Maloui, extending his lead with every stroke. Giannotis there with Weinberger.
A loping stroke, high elbows, breathing off just to one side, to the left side, but then keeping an eye on his direction. Here's the chase group. Lurz, in fact, is at the back of that chase group. Weinberger and Giannotis are the ones that are trying to catch this man, but I don't know that they'll do it because he is picking it up even more. That rolling kick is now consistent with a six-beat sprinter's kick. He can feel it. He knows it's not too far away.
Maloui and Weinberger, who were first and second in the FINA qualifier in Portugal. And they're first and second in this race. Geniotis in his fourth Olympic Games. Successful over 10 kilometers at the World Championships in Shanghai last year. Was second in the 5K, so he has got some sprint background which might just assist him as he tries at the moment to claim the silver medal, because the way it's shaping up, it doesn't look as though anybody is going to catch Oussama Mahlouli of Tunisia.
28 years of age, Mahlouli. So I wonder if this will be the last Olympic Games for him, or whether he'll go on to another to try and medal again in the 1500 and open water.
Geniotis is still going strong at 32.
Yes. I mean, injuries is something that does play a role in most swimmers' career, although it doesn't have the same impact injuries as a lot of the dry land sports, shoulders. And Mahlouli has suffered from a nagging shoulder injury in the lead up to this. He had a back injury previous to that. There's the kick, still almost like a little propeller at the back of a boat, surging him forward.
The gold medal winner in the pool, a bronze medal winner at London 2012. Is Mahlouli set to add to that collection? That's the distance between the front four and the remainder of the field of 25 who set out. It was very much high noon in London.
Mahlouli's direction has been impeccable. And if anything, the three boys that are a touch more experienced behind him haven't quite done the impeccable job that Mahlouli has, because they've been racing and focusing on each other. A battle, well, four doesn't go into three medals, does it? And there's Mahlouli and then these three boys. So one of them will miss out on a medal unless the clock can't separate them.
Well, he has ignored the feed again. Second lap in succession that Mahlouli has said, no thanks, I'm carrying on.
Must be a plan, though, because the coach is not even bringing it out as an offer for any of these lead boys. And none of them rolling over to take on any gel feeds either. So these boys, they're tough. And stamina's there. So that was the timing, or the finishing line that we could see in that previous shot. So just half a lap to go.
I think Lertz has made his move now. I think he has pushed on and may have claimed second place ahead of Weinberger and Geniotis.
Good time to make it. I think we're only about 5 minutes away from the finish.
It's a big ask for any of the three to the left of your picture to now catch the leader, Oussama Mahlouli of Tunisia. Phenomenal swim. Someone who only swam over 10 kilometers for the first time competitively back in the spring in Mexico. Disappointed with his performance on that day. Felt that he learnt an enormous amount and was able to push on and win the qualifying race in Portugal in June.
Not losing any of his velocity, not losing anything in fatigue or stiffness, as these boys battle it out for the silver and bronze medals. You're right, Thomas Lertz, who is the most experienced of the field, just breaking away a little bit. And this is the second chase group.
Lertz undefeated in his last 10 races at World Championships over 5 and 10K. Male open water swimmer of the decade in 2010, but he's got a new rival now, the Tunisian Oussama Mahlouli.
Our new player in the scene. And you know what? It may give Mahlouli a little bit of enthusiasm to continue on with victory in a discipline of swimming that he hasn't had a lot of experience, a lot of time with. Maybe he starts dreaming about how much better he can get. But we do have about 4 minutes, 5 minutes to go. And I wonder whether or not the pace that he's been setting has started to just get to him a little bit in terms of his fatigue levels. The choice of not feeding on the last two stations. Let's see what the gap is between Mullooly and Lertz. Well, it's considerable, isn't it? So he rounds this boy for the last time, and he'll straighten up and keep his eye open for the finishing touch pad. They would have had a briefing pre-race just to remind the boys where that touch pad is, as opposed to just the lap arch. Look at that gap.
And they make sure they'll slap that board firmly as well. You don't want to make a mistake like that as you cross the finish line.
Well, he's an educated boy as well. He's graduated from University of Southern California, where he trains with the Trojan Swim Club, which is a swim club that's really pitched to postgraduates to keep these athletes in the sport past university. Osama, or Os as he's known, completed a computer engineering, computer science degree. So he probably has the ability to do race analysis as well. The race is on for the silver.
Mullooly of Tunisia powering on, as he has done for each of the last two laps. Trying to drag the field along during the first lap, was happy then to take something of a backseat just to settle back in the pack, but has upped the tempo and increased the pace, particularly on the fifth lap, which he completed in 17 minutes and 45, faster even than the opening 1.7 kilometers of this circuit in Hyde Park. And Mullooly, who's got gold and bronze in the pool, is set now for a marathon success over 10 kilometers. The open water swim, another swimmer who's successfully transferred from the pool to the open water, on his way to another gold medal. Not far now.
Time to stand up, Tunisia, and cheer your athlete on. What an absolute superstar for your country. Gold, a bronze, and now another gold in the open water. He's trained remarkably hard for this moment. It's lasted just under 2 hours, where he'll be crowned Olympic champion once again.
Mullooly with no company. We had a sprint finish in the women's race over 10 kilometers yesterday. Oussama Mullooly of Tunisia, the leader of the men's 10 kilometer marathon. And he surges on. Success in the pool over 1500 meters. A bronze medal in London, a gold medal at the distance in Beijing. Mullooly of Tunisia to claim another gold. This one for the open water swim. Mullooly of Tunisia has done it in a time of under 1 hour and 50 minutes. Followed in by Lertz of Germany. Weinberger of Canada has the bronze. And there's disappointment and a fourth place for Spiros Giannotis of Greece.
The race is on now for the final placings. These boys have done a remarkable performance to make 10 kilometres. And I think this might be fog coming in for Great Britain. If it is, he has made some big moves on the field in this last lap to get himself there. We'll see when the timing comes up, but certainly the blue cap of fog coming in now. And if that's Kai Hurst in behind, these boys were in 22nd. It is. It's not Hurst though. Great effort by Daniel Fogg getting into fifth. He was in 22nd at one stage on about lap three or four.
Terrific recovery by Daniel Fogg. And the two Russians coming through together. Savage, who briefly challenged amongst the first five or six. Prinsloo was in the chasing group, but they were beaten really by the pace injected by Oussama Maloui of Tunisia.
Hard to stand up after you've spent 10 kilometres being supported by the water. Means a lot to these swimmers to get a fast time in the final stages. Here is our Japanese swimmer, Haire.
Relief at last. They've completed the 10-kilometre marathon.
Oh, you can hear it. You can hear how hard it was. Kaihurst just getting on for 20th. Here's Maloui. Here's your Olympic champion. Yeah!
He said he was going to show the world when he switched from the pool to the open water. Disappointed with his first swim in Mexico back in the spring, but he won the FINA qualifying event in Portugal in June. And more importantly, he's now won a gold medal.
Oh, one of the local Tunisian photographers traveling all that way to see an amazing performance by Oussama Maloui. Our first ever competitor from Ecuador at the Olympic Games in open water finishes in 21st. Took a lot of heart. He's certainly indicating that, Oussama Maloui, in his post-race celebrations, cheering now our Kazakhstan swimmer, Kudnov. And I'm hoping that our last competitor, Schultz from Guam, will get through as well. He'll be quite some time away from finishing.
Such an effort to complete this 10-kilometer marathon. It's a lot harder when you come in 22nd and 23rd place, unlike the winner, Maloui. Delighted to have jumped out of the water with a gold medal to go with the bronze that he won in the pool.
2.6 seconds was the winning margin. Well, they haven't updated it actually in terms of the winning margins, because we haven't had the sixth lap completed in terms of our split times. But 1:49.55, so he was under that 1 hour and 50 minutes, Oussama Maloui.
Maloui of Tunisia, followed home by Lertz of Germany, Weinberger of Canada, Janiotis of Greece, who was born in England, who was born in the United Kingdom, and who has an English mother. He finished in fourth, just missing out on a medal. Daniel Fogg of Great Britain surged through to finish in fifth place, followed by the two Russians, Bolshakov and Diachin. Vashberger of Germany, who featured among the leaders early on, had to settle for eighth place. And the Bulgarian, the experienced Bulgarian, who says that this will be his last year, Stoichev, was placed ninth. Meyer of the USA was 10th. But this is the winner, Maloui of Tunisia.
No confusion with the touch of the timing pad, and it was 3.4 seconds the margin between first and second. And his technique held him the whole way through. It pays to work hard on that technique in training, because when you start racing and racing hard over 10 kilometres, it stays with you from start to finish. Very popular boy in world swimming. Lots and lots of friends right around the world that will be exceptionally happy, none more so than his family and friends and the country of Tunisia.
Africa's first ever swimming gold medalist.
What relief for him after almost 2 hours of racing, to know that the gamble of nominating for open water. He saw Grant Hackett attempt it in 2008. The Olympic champion from 2004 was Hackett. He tried to qualify for the Australian team in 2008 and the Olympic Games in 2008, and it didn't work. So it was a gamble and a risk also for Osama Mululi.
Mululi, of course, beating Hackett in the 1500 metres in Beijing. Recorded the second best time ever over 1500 metres in Rome at the World Championships a year later. And 3 years beyond that, he's emerged as the winner of the 10-kilometre marathon.
Well, it is Tunisia's first gold medal at these Olympic Games as well, prior to Osama's victory. Tunisia had won just two medals, a silver and a bronze, and now they have the complete set with a gold, silver and bronze to the country. And Osama Mululi being responsible for the gold and the bronze.
Swims for the Trojan Swim Club in Los Angeles. He's studying, as you mentioned, computer engineering and computer science at the University of Southern California. Big tradition of swim success there.
In fact, quite a few gold medalists from that squad. And Rebecca Soni being another of the gold medalists that trains with Osama Mululi at US Trojans under Dave Salo. Athletes are required, particularly the first, second and third place getters, to sign in for drug testing, doping control. It's an integral part also now of world sport, which we're all very relieved about. It means that the performances are based off those even playing field performances for athletes.
Bronze then for number 21, Weinberger of Canada, who won the test event, the London International in August of last year. Won that by a margin of 26 seconds, but he admitted that he hadn't really got the finishing speed necessary to burn off the opposition. So he decided to take the race on, but he couldn't take on Mululi. Far quicker in the water. But only 22. Lertz of Germany emerging with the silver medal, the experienced German.
He was consistent the whole way through as well, Weinberger. Great performance from him. Improving considerably, boy from University of Victoria in Canada.
He was the leader after the end of the first two laps. Not that it made a huge amount of difference, but he was consistent. He was always in the top four or five.
The form as well of Thomas Lertz.
Silver for Lertz after his bronze in Beijing.
It's been a remarkable career for him. This is when he was battling it out midway through the race with Mululi, and Mululi made the move well and truly leading into lap number six, the final lap. Lertz showing the experience that he has acquired over many, many years of open water or marathon swimming. He made some really good tactical choices. He didn't try to go too early. He put a little turn of pace on in lap number two, Mululi, and then just was happy to sit back, but was never out of contact of the top three. And then when he wanted to go, the body was ready and responded.
And you admire his technique, the fact that he was so economical in the water.
His technique is far superior to anybody else's that was in the water. And from an energy point of view, that does help. There's so many dynamics and aspects that go into great marathon swimming. The feed side of things was interesting, that there was no choice to feed in the last two laps. But he has, world's his oyster, really. He's not done this very much, and he comes out on top, number one at the Olympic Games.
Has he set the bar higher for everybody else now? given his success in the pool?
You know, he's probably opened the thought processes of a lot more of the pool swimmers, whether or not they can also make the transition. Are we still waiting for one more competitor to come through, our youngest competitor of the field?
Swimmer from Guam, the 16-year-old.
Trains on the Gold Coast with Dennis Cottrell, so a training partner of Sun Yang, who won the 1500 here in London.
And can take a lot of satisfaction from this year, because he qualified with this swim in Portugal in June. Only the top 25 in the world considered for the Olympic Games. Huge effort on his part, Benjamin Shuli of Guam.
Says he's just using this one as experience. And from a technique point of view, although he doesn't have the pacing of a Mululi, he also has a very nice technique, not too different to Sun Yang or Grant Hackett that have come from the same stable as Ben. And his mum will be happy to know that he's finished it. She was worried about him beforehand, speaking to Kai Hurst and asking him to take care of him out there. Really not too far behind, too. 12 and a half minutes behind the leader.
Pupil at Miami High in Queensland, in Australia.
The Gold Coast, it's the home of the Commonwealth Games in 2018.
And what a response from another huge crowd.
We'll see Ben racing again at the Olympics, no doubt. As he eyes off the timing pad, the final competitor, number 25 of the Marathon Swimming for London 2012. And in fact, this closes off the aquatics program, or swimming program, for London 2012.
The crowds have been phenomenal throughout, and they are standing as one to welcome Ben Shuli of Guam, the final finisher in this field of 25.
...13 minutes and 40 seconds behind, but a fantastic performance for finishing this course, just 16 years of age. He'll have a little bit of trouble getting out and getting on his legs.
Understandably happy to take a breather. And when he gets out of the Serpentine, he will see the podium as we await the victory ceremony of this men's 10-kilometer marathon. And here is the result of that 10K. Mului of Tunisia, the winner. 3.4 seconds ahead of Thomas Lertz of Germany, bronze medalist 4 years ago. Weinberger of Canada took bronze. Gianniotis of Greece, he was 10 seconds behind, just missing out, 5 seconds behind Weinberger. They were the top four. Fogg of Great Britain finished fifth, some distance behind the Gianniotis. It was the pace of Mului which made all the difference.
And it was the smart tactics as well. We saw Mululi looking to just sit in the field, be happy just to be in the top three, take some turns when he needed to in terms of picking up the pace. Weinberger was right there. In fact, he was first across the line on lap one and lap two. Daniel Fogg was there early, and he had a great performance to eventually get into fifth, because at one stage on one of the timings of the laps, maybe lap three, he was in about 22nd. In fact, he was equal 22nd at the end of the fourth lap. So that is a fantastic effort for Daniel Fogg. This is pre-race as Thomas Lertz gets ready for 10 kilometres of pain and punishment. Alex Meyer did all right. He got into 10th. So given that he broke a collarbone in the lead up to this, that's a wonderful performance. It has been a hampered preparation for him. Beautiful technique of Mullooly, soft hands, feeling for the water. It's always important to make sure that from a lever point of view, the hand and the forearm, they're all one lever. There's no bending, there's no breaking of it. His direction was wonderful. He's negotiating the buoys and the turning buoys. Really was a perfect performance, and it was a fast performance. 1 hour 49 minutes 0.55, as the crowd now waits to hear the Tunisian anthem, first time at London 2012, second time in Osama Mullooly's career, so a big thrill for him.
The sun really has shone on London 2012 today, and it's shone on Oussama Mullooly of Tunisia, winner of the men's 10-kilometer swim marathon. We await the victory ceremony. There's a chance for the swimmers to collect their thoughts and to meet one or two of their friends and family and say hello again and thank you to their coaches.
I was just thinking that the preparation for the men's victory ceremony is slightly different to the women's victory ceremony, although when you are an open water or marathon swimmer, there is always a need to clean up after a race, just to give the face a wipe, to take away any of the evidence of whatever space of water you've been swimming in. And this time it's the Serpentine. The girls spend some time perhaps putting their hair up or doing their hair. The boys, well, they don't necessarily have to worry about that, but I'm sure they do want to look their best for the medal presentation.
Take a fair amount of shower gel to get the body covering that Mullooly had on.
Yes, he did have a lot of grease going on there, but I'm sure he's walked away without any rub marks from his swimming costume. He did choose to have the full-length costume, and you'll be surprised at how much of the local Serpentine environment actually probably went down the front of that swimming costume. Thankfully, though, in this space of water, no jellyfish or anything like that to worry about.
But plenty of pond life and algae, which we saw on one or two of the super slow-mo shots. Some fantastic coverage yet again of the men's 10-kilometer marathon. And two or three times there was bits of the Serpentine which flew up out of the water.
Getting a free ride.
Yeah.
No, they have done a wonderful job in cleaning it up and presenting it.
I doubt whether or not Malou would be tempted back on Christmas Day for a swim with the Serpentine Swimming Club, but you never know.
Maybe a little bit too cold for him, I'd say. So it was a beautiful 21 degrees in the water today. I would suggest much cooler at Christmas time when the local swimmers have their swim. And it's a brave thing for the pool swimmers because they're used to 25.5 to 27.5 degrees in there. Confines of a comfortable indoor swimming pool with the black lanes and the lane ropes, and it's a 5-degree drop for Osama Mullooly into a 21-degree water temperature.
cérémonie des vainqueurs du marathon de natation du 10 km hommes.
Ladies and gentlemen, the victory ceremony for the men's 10 km marathon swimming.
So we have the victory ceremony for the men's 10 kilometer marathon in Hyde Park. Fantastic swim by Oussama Maloui of Tunisia. Second gold medal that he has won. He won a gold in the pool in Beijing. He's won bronze in the pool in London. Maloui, the dominant swim, getting home ahead of Thomas Lurz of Germany, who was a bronze medalist in the 10K 4 years ago. Third place went to Weinberger of Canada, Richard Weinberger, the 22-year-old.
Oh, he's really enjoying this moment, Oussama Maloui, so he should.
The medals will be presented by Mr. Lambis Nikolaou, Greece, representing the International Olympic Committee.
IOC member for Greece presenting the medals.
No medal for Spiros Giannotis, though, of Greece, who finished fourth in his fourth Olympics.
Mr. Dimitris Tiasasopoulos, Executive Board Member, International Swimming Federation.
FINA, the International Swimming Federation, represented with the presentation of flowers.
Medaille de bronze, representant le Canada.
What a big moment for the boy from Moose Jaw in Canada.
Richard Weinberger.
It's a bronze medal for Richard Weinberger of Canada.
22 years of age, improving considerably from the World Championships last year. He was 17th there, and this time he steps up onto the dais. Canada's third medal in the swimming pool. Given that the Serpentine I'm counting as a swimming pool, the aquatics program.
Winner of the London Invitational in August of last year. Then he beat Thomas Lurz by 26 seconds. It is the German who emerges with a silver medal here.
Representing Germany, Thomas Lurz.
Well, he tried, didn't he? He didn't let Maloui get away too far, and the final margin was 3.4 seconds. A wealth of experience. Now stepping up to a silver medal at the Olympic Games, Thomas Lurz.
Silver for Lurz after his bronze in Beijing. He was a pool swimmer in Athens back in 2004. Oussama Maloui of Tunisia, a bronze medal already in the pool. Here it's gold for Oussama Maloui.
Great result. Clearly emotional by the performance.
Maloui twice now an Olympic champion, champion over 1500 meters. In 2008, when he defeated Grant Hackett, now a 10K winner in the open water.
S'il vous plaît, veuillez vous lever pour l'hymne national de la Tunisie.
Please stand for the national anthem of Tunisia.
It is gold for Tunisia. It is gold for Oussama Maloui.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Olympic medalists.
Clearly excited by it. And so he should be, a newcomer to marathon swimming. In the first time at the Olympic Games, Maloui takes it out. Only the second time that marathon swimming has appeared at the Olympic Games. And Lertz has been part of the medals on both occasions.
Bronze then for Weinberger of Canada, silver for Lertz of Germany, gold for Maloui of Tunisia. So that completes our coverage from Hyde Park, where Oussama Maloui of Tunisia has added to his bronze in the pool by winning gold over 10 kilometres.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have witnessed a tremendous display of open water swimming, a true Olympic performance. I think we saw everything today. We saw the fast pace going out. We saw a tremendous tactical race with people trying to break, people trying to be covered. We saw the big packs developing, the single lining, the going wide, trying to cover everything going through. And we saw on the final two laps an absolute domination by our new Olympic champion from Tunisia, in a sensational display of control, of stamina, and of speed. The Olympic champion who dominated, Oussama Maloui.